Eloheinu, Melech Haralem, Asher, Kishanu, Bemitzvotav, Vezivanu, Lo'asak, Bindere, Torah. Please, Adonai, make the Torah's words sweet in my mouth and in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name in the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Adonai, who gave us the Torah of truth. Amen. You may be seated. Can you imagine it is part 12? Are you cold? And see, I was actually hot. I was like going to take this. I have a t-shirt. I was going to take this shirt off. I was like, wow, I am so hot. But I realized that you are probably chilly, aren't you? Sister Gail said, never say cold. Never say cold. That's because she's been here from the very beginning, and we remember what it is to have no heat and air in here. Remember, Minister Tammy? Hallelujah. We'd be in here 2 minutes, and we'd be like a puddles all around us. Well, we are in part 12. Can you imagine we've been going through for 3 months on self-worth? That time goes fast when you're having a good time. I think I'll have one more week after this, and then we're going to go into the second segment, which is self-improvement. Now that we understand about self-worth, we're going to start getting to self-improvement. Amen? I may need some improvement. I mean, everyone needs an oil change every once in a while, your engine checked, and your tires inflated. Hallelujah. We've been using these scriptures as foundation, and I just like to read them. I know that you know them, but hopefully by the time we're done a year from now, you will have at least memorized some of these foundational scriptures. The first one, Psalms 139, 13 through 24, except for 19 through 22. For you fashioned my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I thank you because I am, say it with me, awesomely made wonderfully. Your works are wonders. I know this very well. My bones were not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven into the depths of the earth. Your eyes could see me as an embryo, but in your book, all my days were already written. My days had been shaped before any of them existed. God, how I prize your thoughts, how many of them there are. If I count them, there are more than grains of sand. And if I finish the count, I am still with you. Examine me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is in me any hurtful way and lead me along the eternal way. Look at verse 15. Go back and look at verse 15. Do you see a word in there that has to do with Sukkot? Anyone remember my sermon on Saturday? Woven, right. He's woven us. He has, it's Sukkot among us. He has woven himself within us. Can you imagine? There's Sukkot in there. Isn't that glorious? He has woven. Very good. You get the prize. Who said it? Amen. You get a candy bar next time I buy one. Look at the next one. Also, remember we use this on Saturday, on Sabbath, has also something to do with Sukkot. For I will take you from among the nations, gather you from all the countries, return to you to your own soil. Then I will what? Sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean. The water libation. I will cleanse you from all your uncleanness and from all your idols. Or if you're from Morocco, what do? We throw water on, just on me, we throw water on each other. That's funny. You're the only one from Morocco. See how these people are? No wonder it's a cyclical God. I have to ask forgiveness all the time. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit inside of you. I will take the stony heart out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit inside you and cause you to live by my laws, respect my rulings, and obey them. So we have Psalms that has to do with Sukkot. We have Ezekiel that has to do with Sukkot. And then Philippians. Oh. Does that have to do with Sukkot? Yes, because the word rejoice is what? Meaning dance, which is hog, which is feast, which is the feast. Rejoice in union with the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see how reasonable and gentle you are. The Lord is near. Don't worry about anything. On the contrary, make your requests known to God by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Then God's shalom, passing all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds safe in union with the Messiah, Yeshua. In conclusion, brothers, what? Focus your what? Your thoughts on what is true, noble, righteous, pure, lovable, admirable, on some virtue or on something praiseworthy. Keep doing what you have learned and received from me, what you have heard and seen me doing. Then the God who gives shalom will be with you. Hallelujah. We have spent the last couple of weeks talking about thoughts. And when you have thoughts, if you're not careful, it turns into emotions, right? And you have thoughts before you have emotions. Well, tonight we're going to talk about actions, because the sequence would be thoughts, emotions, and actions. All right? Now, I am sure that you remember a time when you probably said, I can't believe I did that. Has anyone ever said that? I can't believe I ate the whole thing. That was a commercial, but I can't believe I did that. And the thing about it is that can be something positive. I can't believe I did that. But a lot of times, most of the time, I would probably say when we say I can't believe I did that, it usually comes after you did something that was not consistent with your values. Something kind of outside of what you normally would have done. Something triggered you. You're kind of at a shock. You're at a loss for words. I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I said that. I can't believe I acted that way. And so it usually means we are doing something that's not consistent with our values, whether we spoke maybe impatiently with the child and usually we're very patient, or whether we acted in an unkind way and we're usually very kind to our friends, but today was not a good day. Or we responded kind of disrespectfully to your parents, and if you've done that, then, you know, you kind of feel bad and you try to, you know, make up for that. But even though inside your heart you knew that your behavior was wrong, even though you did something you didn't want to do, or you did something, I should say, that you can't believe you did it, even though you know that that behavior was wrong, that seems that you still can't or didn't stop it from manifesting itself. And we see that a lot of times in our lives. We do something that we know is wrong. To him that knoweth to do good, and to him that doeth not, to him it is sin. And so what he's trying to tell us is we still do it, even when we know not to do it, right? Well, there is the flip side. And the flip side is, what makes you act kindly? What makes you act thoughtfully? What's the real person or the real reason, I should say, that you lend a sympathetic ear to a friend that has problems, even though you're very busy? You know, you sit down and you listen. What gets you out of bed, even though you're exhausted? I mean, that's the flip side of, I can't believe I did that, right? Well, there's many factors that are involved, and certainly emotions are involved, because we've been trying to deal with the inside out and trying to make sure that we, you know, grab a hold of those emotions, and we made the connection that the thoughts are there before the emotions are there. And so we realize that positive feelings lead us to have a really good day. Gives us a smile, gives us maybe some laughter, gives us some pleasant things in our lives, especially positive things. If you wake up tomorrow morning and really decide to focus your thoughts and have a positive feeling, most likely you'll have a good day. Remember, we said just a couple services ago, the last service, that how you enter is how you exit. So, you know, how you enter tomorrow morning is really going to be how you really exit that day. Now, on the other hand, when you feel negative, and we've all been there, when we feel angry, we've all been there, when we feel resentful, you find yourself acting in hurtful ways throughout the day. So however you've decided to start it, you know, it's hard, it's easier to just in the beginning to just say, I'm going to be in a good mood, than it is to get out of a bad mood. How many's ever tried to get out of a bad mood? It doesn't really work. You kind of have to be by yourself. You kind of have to, you know, retreat a little bit. You kind of have to don't want to be around the same people, see the same faces. You know what I'm saying? And it takes a moment, or 3 or 10, or a week, month, to overcome those things. Now remember, your emotions don't always determine how you will act. Correct? Because what we said was, remember, some people do good, nice things, not because they're good and nice, but because they get something in return, right? Looking for praise, looking for gratification of some sort. Maybe they're going to get some money or a reward. And what we said was that really is something that you can only see from the inside, because God looks on the inside of the heart. I did say, however, that the majority of people that do something good and nice are actually just doing it to be good and to be nice. But we don't know. Only God knows. Correct? Now, there are times when we all act in ways that do not match our values or feelings, whether they are positive or negative. which means you can be in a bad mood and you know enough that when you get out of the car to come to your job or the church, you don't let anyone see you are in a bad mood. You could have had a fight with your wife, and then when you come in, you're still holding hands and looking at each other. But behind the scenes in those eyes are daggers, if you could have just get them out. But no one knows, because you know that it's not worth bringing that stuff in, so you kind of just pull yourself up. So there are times when we all act ways that don't match our values. So what besides our feelings determines how we act? What compels us to behave kindly or sometimes unkindly, to be patient or sometimes impatient, to be forgiving or sometimes unforgiving? What besides our feelings determine how we act? Why are there some times that we react negatively to a situation, while other times we are able to resist the temptation to yell, to be hurt, to cause pain, to mistrust others, even when we are provoked? And let's face it, we've been through some of the same scenarios, and sometimes we do good, and sometimes we don't do so good. Sometimes we're able just to blow it off, you want to say it that way, or forgive immediately, or understand the situation. And then there's other times you don't resist the temptation, and you just let all hell loose that you've been holding on for a while. You know, even you know, talks about the demons bowing before God. Even demons shudder when you open up those gates and you start becoming what you don't want to become. Even they step back. Okay, whatever. They're in a bad mood. Let's not even mess with them today. So here's what you need to think. Here's what we want to get to today and jump off this. If it's not an internal emotion that causes our behavior, it must be an internal thought that fuels the action. If it's not an internal emotion that causes our behavior, it might be an internal thought that fuels the action. Whether it's your emotion or your thought, your internal world sets the tone for how you will act. My point is, you can have a thought that turns into emotion. Your emotions can cause thoughts to come that don't need to be there. So if you have thoughts and emotions and then actions, you also have thoughts that bypass emotions and go right to actions. There's a lot of different scenarios that you can have with these three little people or three little things in your life called thoughts, called emotions, and called actions. Sometimes you might not even be aware of the thought that sits behind your choices. And other times the thought can be hidden or unrealized, which means unless you have really created a real good moment where you can recognize some things, we all recognize that there are thinking processes that we don't even know that we're having. We're responding, and we haven't even realized that we have thought something, because we're so in the forefront with our emotions. We're so in the forefront. So in those cases, you may not even notice that there was anything going on inside your head, no pun intended, until you ask yourself, what was I thinking that made me want to do that? What what prompted me? And the thing is, you might not even pay attention to a lot of those thinking processes. You know, it's kind of almost like a dream. You have them, but sometimes you're not even aware that you're having them, but then you are aware that you're having them, but then when you wake up, you can't remember what you had. You know what I'm saying? Have you ever just woken up mad at someone and you don't even realize why you were mad at someone, but actually it was something that was in your dream, but now that you woke up, you forgot your dream, but the thing that remained was the emotion. So you roll your mate out of bed. I don't know why I did that, but I just felt the urge for some reason. So sometimes our hidden internal thoughts are powerful enough to get us to act in ways that are inconsistent with our value, which means most of us have an understanding of the Word of God. We might not know every 613 laws and how it applies, but we do have, if you've been born again for a week, 2 weeks, most of us here have been born again longer than that, the basic value of being a Christian, the basic way that we're supposed to respond and act. I'm not saying that we do it all the time, but we certainly know that we should. Correct? We've known for a long time because of his forgiveness for us that we are to forgive people. Right? We know that. There's not a scripture that can be given to us that's going to be a moment where we say, oh, I never knew that. We know that. We know not to pick up an offense. We know not to be angry. We know not to be smart mouth. We know not to come against authority. We know to respect our parents. We know to give honor where honor. We know those things, right? And sometimes those hidden inner thoughts are powerful enough to override those values that we already know and be inconsistent with the values that we know. And it could be a couple reasons. Maybe sometimes the weight of the world, and when you get the weight of the world and you're carrying a lot of responsibility, you kind of sometimes let your guard down a little bit, right? If you're excessively tired, what you normally would be able to sustain, you can't sustain any longer. Do you know what I'm saying? Where you normally are patient, you now have no patience. Where you normally would gather the child up and hug and say, it's okay, I don't know why you're crying, I don't know. Now you're saying, I don't know why you're crying, but you're getting on my last nerve, go to your room. Just some differences. Maybe people are not being cooperative with you. So, you know, after a while, you're getting annoyed at people. Why don't you just do what you're supposed to do? Why don't you just bring what you're supposed to bring? Why don't you just sign your name where you're supposed to sign your name? Why don't you just come when you're supposed to come? Why don't you just know the time and what time you're supposed to be here? Because they're not working with you, right? And those things can cause impatience. They can cause disrespect, which leads then to regret. Because I don't know about you, but anytime I have acted out in my flesh, regret follows. I didn't say I responded to my regret all the time, which means, oh, I am sorry. But I still had it. How many's ever had that regret but said, I'll live with that regret? I'm living with it. Unless God tells me different. Hallelujah. I got 4 more months to Yom Kippur again. Glory to God. You know what I'm saying? So impatience and disrespect and a lot of things happen. You know, and you see it sometimes maybe if you know someone who's very patient and then you see them interact and then, you know, maybe they're not feeling well and then all of a sudden they act very impatient and all of us would be like shocked. We'd be like, what? They yell at that child. Not that that child didn't need yelling. It was that person. You would have said, well, I would have thought that one would yell at it and that one yell at it, wouldn't it? But you, what? Why would you yell at that person? And there's a lot of things, what I'm saying. There's a lot of things, you know, whether it's thoughts, whether it's emotions, or whether it's those actions that seem to drive us to be inconsistent in our values. And really, when we're talking about inside out, it's really about trying to get us to a very balanced place where we were, I'll say 100%, but we know we won't get there till we die, 100% consistent with the values of the Word of God in our own lives. Where no one has to look at us and say, what? We're very easily to look at people and say, oh, you're being inconsistent or you're disqualifying yourself or whatever, when actually if we looked at ourselves, if it wasn't for the grace and mercy of God, we all would be disqualified. I'd have to lay down this mic and walk away. And the day that I picked up the mic, you would say, oh, he must have had a good day. But I would have to say that probably a lot of days you'd be here waiting for someone to pick up a mic and we'd be like, sorry. You know, the Quakers, they used to come in and then they'd wait for the Ruach HaKodesh and whoever really started to quake, why they were called Quakers, would be the one who had the word of the God, word of the Lord. Well, you know, in some churches, no one would be quaking. Can you imagine just coming in? I mean, that takes great faith to come in just to whoever the Spirit of God falls on. If you were in a bad mood and you felt like a little tremor coming, you'd be like, no! Can't do it. So let's look at this relationship. There's a relationship between thoughts, emotions, and actions. They can either be the Holy Trinity or they can be demonic Trinity. as Pastor Kenny says. That's demonic. Thoughts, emotions, and actions. They are separate of themselves, but yet they are together because they interact with one another. They are woven, if you want to say it that way, which is why it's very important that you really focus on the first one, which is thoughts, because that's the one that God zones in on, isn't it? That's the one he says. He doesn't say renew your emotions. He doesn't say renew your actions. He says faith without actions is dead, but he's expecting the actions and the emotions to to come in line with your thought. So what he wants you to do is to change your thought, then emotions change and actions start changing. So let's look at this relationship. Number one, thoughts can lead to emotions, right? You think I'm tell you what, it's on my last server. I'm just going to yell at them the next time they come here. What do you do? You've already loaded your gun. You're already ready to yell at them, all right? Number two, thoughts can lead to actions, which means thoughts can bypass emotions and go right to actions, okay? And I'll explain that in a minute. Well, I can explain it now just very simply. Again, if you're in a bad mood when you arrive at church, you realize that being in a bad mood is not the place to be while you're at church. So what do? You hold those emotions in. You come in. You smile. You're nice. You're happy. You go through church. You praise him. You worship him. And when do you pick up your bad mood? When you get home or when you get in the car. It depends. It depends if you come in alone or you come with a person who made you in a bad mood. So actually, the thoughts say to you, you're in a bad mood, you're angry, you're resentful, but you're in church. You can't be that way. So your thoughts tell you to bypass your emotions. You come in with different actions, but all along you still have that turmoil, but no one can see it because you have learned to put on that mask. And it's not a bad mask. And we're going to talk about it. It's not a bad mask. I'd rather you just keep hell away from us than bring hell to us, right? Then you have the third one. Emotions can lead to actions, which means you have these emotions just so on your shoulder that they just lead to actions right away. You bang, boom, bang, 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 bang. Hello. Why you say hello to me? Why are you saying it to me? Why not only me? What's going on? It's just right there, okay? And so we have these thoughts that are internal. We have these emotions that are internal. And yet then we have these actions that are what? That are external, all right? So when we look at these three, the question we need to ask ourselves is this. Why is this important? Did you get that? Do I need to go back? You didn't get it? Go back. It's fine. Go back so they can get that last one. We're going to ask ourselves the question, why is this important? Other than the obvious, why is this important? Tell me when you got it, because I got it. Everyone else got it? Because I don't want you to hold any emotions. All right, this is the reason why it's important, because to get to the core of Tikkun HaMidos. Now, again, what is Tikkun? People, I'm going over this every time. What is Tikkun? Don't make my emotions. What is Tikkun? Repair. What is Ha? The, what is Midos? Character or attributes. To repair the character. So to get to the core of Tikkun HaMidos, what needs to be repaired, okay? What needs to be fixed. In order to get to the core to it, we first must realize or recognize that we have internal work to do. And I've said this from the get-go. I've said it from the beginning. But I have to say it over and over and over and over again because we hear it, but we're not applying it to our lives. Because we're still not focusing on repairing ourselves. And maybe for some, one of the reasons why is because the step alone can be very daunting. Because you're looking at yourself and what you got to fix. And you're thinking, wow, I don't know if I have enough life to fix all that. Because again, you know what's going on inside you, right? We don't. You do. But who else also knows? Yahweh. So he's not scared of you, right? And he can handle you. He's handled you all along, correct? So let's go back to the first steps that we've learned from the very beginning. The first step is what? Observe yourself. Take note of your thoughts, your feelings, and your actions. Let's be honest with ourselves. Have you been doing that on a regular basis? To really propel yourself and to say, I really want to renew my thoughts, that has to be done. That has to be done. Because the only time you'll take note of your thoughts is when you deem it important to think. And you can't do it that way, because some things that you think you're right and justified in are not right and justified. So you got to keep track, because what is your standard? The word. Don't run it through your mind and saying, should I have? Is this all right? Can I feel this way? Because 99% of the time you will tell yourself, sure, you're all right. You're perfectly fine to think that way. And we have to observe ourselves. Stop observing each other and observe ourselves. Take note of whose thoughts? Your thoughts. And whose feelings? Your feelings. And whose actions? Your actions. Because your thoughts and your feelings and your actions, like we said last week, will alert you. Will alert you. When Sister Gail teaches, what song does she sing? Alert your face. All right? Alert your face. You have to know when your face is in a way that shouldn't be that way. Right? So if someone says, what's wrong? Look at your face. You need to stop and say, hold on, and go to a mirror real quick so you can see what it looks like. So you can try to stop it. Right? When they say something, you do that with your eyes, the way you, or how you look, or something. We all have those things, right? Once you see the red flags, what do red flags mean? Stop. Maybe that's what we should all just have, like little red flags. Little red flags, little green flags, and maybe little yellow flags in our pockets. So when you come through the door and you're having just a moment, maybe you want to put a little yellow flag up. Just say, watch out. I'm working on it. Caution. Caution. Approach me very, very sensitively. And then maybe if someone's doing it, you just red flag. And then when someone does well, we all just lift up a green flag. Woo, that was good. Or maybe not. When you see the red flag, it means that you continue. Everyone say the word continue. 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 The power of this study is not that when we are finished in a year from now, that the day that we finished, you close your notes, you put it away, and we start a new Bible study, and you no longer remember inside out. The power of this study would be that you continue on in the process until the day you die, because throughout all your life, you will still need to tikkun hamidos. You will still need to repair your character. Because it's not going to happen overnight. Because however old you are right now, wow. You had all that time to fix it and it hasn't been fixed yet, right? So you continue the process of what? Personal development, using some different techniques, which we will get into later on, especially when we talk about self-improvement. I'm going to give you some powerful techniques, okay, that's going to help you overcome. But the first technique that I've been telling you is to renew your mind. So everything points back to your thoughts. Actions, emotions, goes back to your thoughts. Everything points back to your thoughts. They lead to both emotions and or actions. Thoughts can go to emotions, which leads to actions, or thoughts can skip emotions and go right to actions. And so working on our thoughts will be a powerful step towards fixing it. How many need fixing? I do. So let's look at one red flag. Red flag number one, a person who engages in mean or hurtful actions. That's pretty obvious, isn't it? They're just always engaged in something mean or hurtful actions. That's a red flag, and you can even catch yourself in that, because, again, this is not necessarily looking at other people, so you can go around and put little red flags on people. It's really about you. And do you find yourself sometimes engaging in mean or hurtful actions? And it doesn't have to be big, hurtful actions or large, mean things. I mean, it can be simple things, but they're still mean. Do you know if I walk through the hall and you walk through the hall and you recognize me and I say hello and you don't say hello, that might not seem like a big thing, but that can be mean and hurtful. Well, it's rude just for the simple reason if that's not what you do. But if the reason why you didn't say hello is because it was me, then that's mean and hurtful is what I'm saying. So, I mean, that's different than, you know, slapping somebody or tripping someone or running them over with your car. That's really mean and hurtful. But even the simple ignoring, not saying, that's mean and hurtful because you know, especially if they said hello, you did not say hello to hurt them, to be mean to them. Because there's no reason not to say hello to someone who has said hello, right? So that means red flag number one. And if that person who said hello has a moment, they might say to you when they walk by, red flag number one, but they won't because they're learning. Red flag number two, a person who stays in a negative emotion. A person who stays in a negative emotion. Now, that can be something that you see, and it can also be something that you do not see. Because we are used to covering things up. And so the person who stays in a negative emotion. So let's just say you've had some altercation with someone, and years down the line, you still have some of that negative emotion. That's a red flag. Because guess what? When should that negative emotion leave you? Immediately. Now, God says it this way. Don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. So he gives you that moment. He tells you, don't go to bed angry. And again, he's not giving you a timeline. Like, so if you're going to get mad at someone, yell at someone, you yell at them in the morning. So you have all day to deal with it. He's just giving you a timeline, like 7 times 70. He's not saying that, you know, when you reach that multiplication, you can start writing people off. What he's given you is almost an unrealistic time to forgive people, because what he's saying is you won't ever be offended by that same person that many times in one day. Even if you spent 24 hours with them, it would almost be impossible unless you're just really having a really, really, really bad day. So, you know, a person who stays in the negative. So if you find yourself, when that occurred, that the next day you're still in that negative, or the next day after that you're still in that negative, that's a red flag for you. And the red flag is not to say why that happened. The red flag is saying, why is that remaining with me? What thinking process, what emotion, what actions, you know, or the action is exhibited, you know, within you, even though people can't see it. So let me give you like an example. If you decide to spend a very quiet weekend at home, and you know, you have parents, and when you come home, let's just say, you know, you were in school, you had a very hard day, you had a very bad week, and you were excited about the weekend, and when you come home, the parents had invited relatives there, and so when you walk in, there's your aunt, there's your uncle, there's the cousins, and all the way home, you were thinking, this is going to be a weekend just for me, I'm going to be so excited, it's my weekend, I'm going to be quiet, I'm going to be still, it's going to be exciting, it's going to be a moment, hallelujah, I'm going to grab a book, I'm going to sleep in, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And when you walked through the door, you had all that emotion, you were so excited, and then there's the relatives, and then your parents say to you, or your husband says to you, someone's come from Liberia, or or someone says to you, you know, your relatives are going to stay the weekend with us, and you're like, oh, great. And then it's followed with, and we have to relocate you because they're going to stay in your room. Super. Right? But actually inside, what are you? You're annoyed, you're frustrated, you're angry, you're disappointed. But what are you still doing? You're still trying to smile. You're still trying to, you know, show respect, and you're still trying to be nice because it's your relatives and it's your mom and your dad. They're very excited about their relatives. And so what happens is your thoughts went into an emotion but you withheld the emotion and you changed your thoughts, and your thoughts created a different action. And we see that emotions lead to actions, but that is not always true. Sometimes we keep them hidden because that thought should have said, I'm annoyed, I'm frustrated. And the action would have been what we would have done, rolled our eyes, yelled, screamed, slammed our door. I'm not going up my room, you go up yours. But she changed the thought. And the thought was that she changed was, I love my mother and father, don't want to disrespect my mother and father. I love my relatives, don't want them to feel bad about them coming. Don't want, you know what I'm saying? So her thoughts changed, bypassed the emotions, and changed her action. However, though it bypassed the emotions were still there. So it was great that she had control of the emotions, or that you had control of your emotions. I'm not saying that you shouldn't. But that doesn't mean that the character was good. It still means that she needs, or you or I, need to work on tikkun hamidos. Because if you're still having negative emotion, though you've learned to curtail it and cover it and go on with life, you still have that bad character inside of you that needs to be taken care of. So maybe you're working on developing patience and tolerance. Maybe you're embarrassed to do or say anything in front of your family. Maybe you don't want to disappoint your parents by confusing them. Whatever the reason, I applaud us, or I would applaud you, for coming into church and letting that in the car, or letting that inside of you, and being able to worship God and magnify God and then go home and still have it. But we didn't see it. I applaud you for it. But it doesn't mean your character's good. It just means you still need to work on that character. But you knew enough not to let it out. And that was good. Oh, wow, that was good. Real good. Have you ever been around a husband and wife that decide to fight in public? That's not happy for anyone. Everyone gets awkward. Everyone's like, oh, and they're like, well, if we're gonna fight at home, we might as well fight in front of everybody. No, you're not getting it. We don't want to hear it. We don't want to be involved in it. We don't want to be pulled into it. Unless you're serving popcorn for us to watch, we don't want to be at the movie. We don't want to be at the movie. Shut it down. Take the reel off, put it in your pocket, go home and have it privately. We don't want to be involved. So whatever the reason, there's a strong thought that guides us to act differently than our emotions dictate. Some of us have it, some of us don't. Some of us will come in fighting from the from the car. We'll fight throughout all church. We'll fight in the fellowship hall. Are you all okay? I'm fine. Ask the witch what's wrong with her. No, thank you. No, thank you. Hello. And then we all back off, right? And it just happens during that day there were many visitors, and they happened to be sitting beside you. So now we all try to fix the visitors. And how are you all doing? How's your meal? What's going on with you all? So our actions are always a reflection of our thoughts or our emotions, but sometimes there's a conflict between your thoughts and your emotions. Because emotion says, you're annoyed, show it, right? If you ever listen to your emotions, that's what your emotions say. You're annoyed, show it. Your thoughts say, just be tolerant. You want me to go back? Go back. Poof. Now go forward. No, stay right there. Your thoughts say, just be tolerant. You don't want to embarrass yourself by acting mean. We'll take that scenario with the teenager coming home. The emotion says, I'm annoyed. I should show it. It's my room. You should have asked me. What's going on? No one told me that aunts and uncles were coming. How do you expect me to have my weekend? What's going on? Right? But your thought says, it's your mom, it's your dad, it's your relatives, it's only a weekend, it is your room, but it's okay, you'll get your room back, the couch ain't bad. It's just 2 days. It could be a long weekend, but it's not. Don't embarrass yourself, because you know when you let the emotions out, you not only embarrassed you embarrassed your parents, you made the relatives embarrassed for you and for those parents, right? And you can fix it, but there's still that awkward regret, and there's still that which is now out there. You got it? So flip it. So emotion says you're annoyed, show it. And the thoughts say just be tolerant. You don't want to embarrass yourself by acting mean. And although this passes quickly, we don't even notice the competition going on in our heart and mind. We don't even know sometimes there's a competition. Be quiet, no, speak up. Say what you want to say. No, don't say nothing. It's so quick in this between the heart and mind that we don't even know there's a competition. But here's the thing. Eventually, the stronger thought or emotion wins out, which is why we need to make sure that the strongest thinking in our life is the thinking like Adonai. Because our hearts can be deceitfully wicked. Our minds and hearts can be selfish. And we can say things and do things that even though people will forgive us for, and even though we can kind of like take it back and say, I am sorry, it's still there and it's still hurt. Right? And if we can catch it, bring it down, and bring it in captivity before it gets out, isn't it better to having had changed the way that you view and speak and act than having to always fix it? Right? Just because they can set a broken bone doesn't mean you go to the highest tree and jump off. Right? You don't say, it doesn't matter, they can fix me now. Watch me fall. That would be stupid. You would say, still what? Be careful. You don't want to break a bone. You don't want to hurt yourself. And if that child of yours said, it doesn't matter, you got insurance and they fix up, you would say, get down. You're an idiot right now. Get down. You're acting like an idiot. Get down. I don't know what is wrong with you. Because your thinking's off. Right? So we have to let our positive thought win over our emotion of annoyance. And this will allow you to act in accordance with your neshama. Because remember, your neshama, right? We read it in Psalms, has been woven, right? He has sukkad with you. So he's part of you. The image of God. You've been made in the image of God. You have a neshama. And that neshama, which is your true inner voice, when you start thinking on things that are good, of true and good report and praiseworthy and virtuous, you are actually lining yourself up with the neshama, your inner voice, instead of giving in to the dictates of your yetzer hara. Because your yetzer hara, which is your evil inclination, just thinks about who? You. Myself. What I want. How I feel. What I need to say. When I need to say it. There's no thinking process. There's no stopping thinking. bringing down. Bringing in captivity. Making it be obedient to the word of God. That takes maturity. Doesn't it? And it's harder to do that than to let your mouth open and stuff fly out. It's easy to open your mouth and let things fly out. And then what do you say? Hey, I'm glad I got that off my chest. Well, we're not. We would have preferred you kept it in your chest. I mean, just truthfully, we would have preferred you kept it in your chest. Or at least until you could learn how to bring it out without such venom, without such robust energy that it knocks us all down. Do you know what I'm saying? And if you can't and haven't learned to do that, then it's better you just zip it. Well, that's not who I am. I feel like I'm not. Well, that's right. It's not who you are. That's what we're trying to say. Fix yourself so you could be that. So the yetzer hara doesn't win over your life. What I find is that we recognize, well, that's not who I am, and then that we're not recognizing that that's not what we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be renewed. So if you find some area in your life that's not according to the word of God, and then you feel bad because you can't be yourself, that's a red flag. He's trying to tell you, fix that. Just fix it. It'll take some time, but at least try to fix it. Let me give you an example about thoughts. Here we go. We have a thought, we have an emotion, we have an action. The thought is the kids are noisy and driving you crazy. How many's ever had that thought? I mean, as much as you can push through, there are just some days the kids are noisy and driving you bonkers. Correct? Most days you're nice. Most days you're good. Most days you're sweetie, sweetheart, honey bun, come here. Stop that. That's not good for you. Don't scream so loud. Precious, come on. Then there's other times that you're like, where's the duct tape? It's coming on your face. I don't care whether you want to call 911. It's not happening because the duct tape will stay on there and they can't hear you when you have duct tape on your mouth. Because the emotion now is what? Annoyance. Have you ever just, something that's never really got on your nerve, all of a sudden just started getting on your last nerve? And you feel that emotion. You're like, I am really annoyed. I know that they're only five, but I'm about ready to let them out of the car so they may walk home. I will give them my iPhone for GPS. I would never do that. Facebook, I have people to watch. I'm never. Then action comes. What do? You snap at them. Be quiet. I was going to say shut up, but Gail don't like it. Be quiet. What's wrong with you? What do? Normally when you're trying to be kind, now stop. Now that's not right. You grab their arm. Stop. Or in the old days, your ear. Stop. Did anyone ever have their ear grabbed? My mother and dad grabbed my ear only in church. I was thankful. Because when I was home, it wasn't an ear that they were grabbing. It was a belt and flying around the world. So if you're going to discipline me, let me go to church first. At least I know it's just an ear squeeze. Or that grip on the shoulder. How many's ever had that? Now behave. And that's to your spouse. Kids are noisy, driving you crazy. It drives an emotion of annoyance, which causes an action. You're snapping at the child. All right? Let's look at the next one. Kids are noisy, starting to drive you crazy. But instead of saying, you're driving me crazy, because you know that when they are that way, what are you saying to yourself? They're driving me crazy. You're causing me to lose my mind. I don't know what I'm going to do. You're having all these thoughts. I'm about ready to lose it. I'm about ready to explode. I don't know what I'm going to do. I need to pray right now and ask God to help me. You change your thought. The thought is, I ought to be patient. The thought is, I don't want to embarrass myself by acting unkind, because you know that if you do act that way, people look at you like, oh, man, they're calling social services on you. So you change the thought. The thought then causes you to bypass the emotion. Bypass it by what I'm saying is, you still might have it if you're not have worked on your character, but you're bypassing it. The annoyance has now found a place, right? And now what do? Your action is what? You're acting with kindness. When you bypass the emotion but yet still have it there, it's harder to do kindness. But you can do it, right? Especially if it's your job. If it's not your job, it's a little bit easier to let it fly. But when it's your job, you realize my job is on the line. So I have to remember, patient, money. Pay my bills, pay my rent, pay the gas bill. Precious, honey, come here. Let's not act that way anymore. Okay, precious? And you've done that maybe in front of a parent. That parent walks in, you're about ready to scream and yell at that child, and you change your thinking process. As they're coming in, now, honey, now go tell your mother how you've been acting. We've been trying to get you what you wanted, that mother to wait another 5 minutes. Thought, bypass emotion, and you have this action. It changes. So the thing is, can you think of a time in your life when you were able to use a strong positive thought to help you overcome the draw of a negative emotion. You brought that thought and you overcame it. That thought is an important value or ideal which pushes you to do the right thing even when your feelings tell you otherwise. The ability to stop before you act upon your negative emotions is a great start to tikkun hamidos, even if you're still left with the internal work that will get you to actually feel better. It's a good start. It doesn't mean you've accomplished it, but it does give you a good start that you're able to curb and shut down and be quiet. If you have nothing good to say, you say nothing. Be quick to hear and slow to speak. All these are principles that God has set forth because he knows us, doesn't he? And so if you learn that, then you can still work on repairing that character within you and you're not being fake. I don't like being fake. Be fake. We appreciate your fakeness. Because you're not really being fake. You're being in a place of maturity where you're able to harness, pull back on the mouth. You know, James said about the mouth, right? Yaakov said about the mouth. Being able to be slow to speak, watch your words. Before you speak, think about those things. That's not saying that you're not feeling what you're feeling. What he's saying is do what you need to do and then work on tikkuning the hamidas. Because you shouldn't be feeling what you're feeling, but don't let that go down. Don't let the sun go down on it. Know it, red flag it, realize you got to work on it, and then start working on it. So let me give you two categories before we leave tonight. Two categories of thought processes that you can use to pull yourself away from acting upon negative emotions. Two categories of thought processes, okay? These are the processes you can use to pull you away. Did you all have that? You need that. You need that. Go back again so they can just get the fullness of that statement. Y'all still not frozen yet? We're almost done. So you can go home and you can get out in the car and put your heat on. Some of you have your heater. I think I saw gloves over there. So. You went out and asked Bertha, Bertha, you have your long johns and some gloves I can borrow? You got it? Okay, number one, this is a process. L'shem Shamayim thinking. What is L'shem Shamayim? In the name of heaven. In the name of heaven thinking. We need in the name of heaven thinking. We need to be thinking like heaven. How does heaven think? How does Yeshua think? The thing is, you don't have to guess it. He wrote how he thinks, right? These thoughts, when you think like him, align with your Neshama's voice, that true voice. That Neshama's voice is the Ruach HaKodesh living in your life. The Ruach HaKodesh is telling you how to think like God. The argument is not the situation. The argument is really with the Ruach HaKodesh because you want to respond the way you want to respond. And you want to think the way you want to think, and he's trying to get you to think L'shem Shamayim, in the name of heaven. How would heaven think? How does God think? Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not let this will be done in heaven as it's on the earth. That means heaven has it right, earth has it wrong, and we got to bring heaven's thinking down to our earthly being. You got it wrong, he's got it right. Your thoughts are less, his thoughts are lower, his thoughts are higher. His thoughts are greater, your thoughts are less. You have to understand that. So let's think the way he thinks. There's powerful internal messages that remind you to do the right thing instead of just doing what feels good. Because most of the time we get in trouble because we do just what feels good. And you say, but I don't feel good when I do it. No, but you do feel good because instead of having it bottled up or working on it to get rid of it, it made you feel good to get it out. But that's not biblical.
to get it out that way. If you have aught with a brother, you take a brother, you go to them, and you speak with them. It's what it says. Then if they don't listen, you take two. But we're not talking about that type of hurt. We're talking about just interactions and working with people and speaking to people and how to interact with people. Be aware that the Yetzer Hara, which is your evil inclination, works overtime, telling you you'll feel better if you let it out. Even doctors will tell you, let it out because it causes stress. The stress is not that you let it out or leave it in, because you can let it out and still be stressful. In fact, sometimes letting it out causes other people to be stressful. So now you're stressful, everyone else is stressful. Husband and wife that are arguing, they're letting their stress out, but everyone else in the house is stressed, right? And they're actually not even letting their stress out, because now they're stressful that everyone else now knows the business of their house. So you'll feel better when you let it out. No, here's the thing. L'shem Shamayim thinking is, you'll feel better when you fix it. You'll feel better when you repair the character flaw, where that doesn't occur and causes stress in your life. You'll be better when you try to change your thinking, which changes your emotion, which changes your action. L'shem Shamayim thinking is an example of how Yetzer HaTov wins out over your Yetzer Hara. Philippians 4 says, focus your thoughts on what? Things that are true, things that are pure, things that are of good report, things that are virtuous, things that are praiseworthy. These things, that's allowing your Yetzer HaTov to override your Yetzer Hara. That's your new nature overriding your old nature. You'll feel better when you let it out. Why do you think you'll feel better letting out your old nature when your old nature should have already been dead? That should have been gone. That's a red flag. If my old nature is arising, that means I have dug up the grave and let it out again. And I need to go back to the ground, to the grave, and put it back in, fill it back up, and stop on it, step on it, and pound it so it doesn't ever come back out. So that's the first thinking process. What does God say? How does God say? How does God want you to respond? And again, it's what? It's a process. I said they're thinking processes because it won't happen tomorrow. Will it? Number two, what will they say? Thinking. What will they say? Thinking. And these thoughts convince you not to express your negative emotions because it is socially unacceptable, or because it'll ruin your image or your reputation. This is what's wrong with social media. Social media is that we say things we should have never said. We post things we probably should never post. And what it ends up doing, if we're not careful, ruining the image or reputation. Because we feel like we could share it on social media, and we're causing more damage a lot of times than we're helping anything. So while what will they say thinking is not directly aligned with their neshama, it's a useful tool all the same, since it helps you avoid negative behavior. It doesn't line up with the neshama, which means it's not the Ruach HaKodesh telling you what to say, but it is a sign of maturity that you can shut it down and be quiet, which will then help you work on it while you're shutting it down, because it helps you avoid the negative behavior. It doesn't stop the negative feeling, but it stops the negative behavior. We all have done that all our lives. We don't always do what we feel we want to do. If you've gotten angry at someone, you have a filter. Now I know that the filter is decaying in society today, but you have a filter. You know what to say, what not to say, and sometimes when you say things that you shouldn't have said, when it gets out, you think to yourself, I can't believe I said that. Then you try to justify, I didn't really, mean, a joke, ha-ha, but Actually, what happened is the filter went to sleep, and you said something you shouldn't have said. Now you're trying to pull it back in, and it's hard to pull it back in, right? In today's society, we have no filter because everyone thinks they can say whatever they want to say and feel the what they want to feel and do what they want to do and say what they want to say about everybody, even when you don't know anyone, right? So though it doesn't align with the Neshama, which means it's not the inner voice, not the Ruach HaKodesh leading you to the Lashem Shamayim thinking, it's still a sign of maturity to stop you from acting like a fool, like a crazy person. Let me give you an example as I close with this Lashem Shamayim thinking. Let's just say that you have decided in this new cycle that you've decided that every morning you're going to get up and pray. Every morning you're going to pray. You've decided you're going to pray, okay? So the alarm goes off. When the alarm goes off, it's one of those cool, brisk mornings. You know what I'm saying? When the heat's not really on yet, but yet all the comforters on, so you feel a sense of coolness out, but yet you're so just feeling so good underneath that cover. And you know that when you stick your little toe out, it's going to ruin the moment, correct? And so the alarm goes off, and the first thought is, I am loving this sleep. It is so good. You already know that you made a commitment to get up and pray. But that thought is just tiny. The big thought is, it is so nice right now. And then you make excuses. It was summer for a long time and I couldn't sleep real good. And it's going to be really cold pretty soon. I'm going to have the heat on. This is the perfect storm. So, what do? You hit the snooze because your emotions say to you, it's okay to be lazy today. Oh, you missed the last line? I thought you were acknowledging you love to sleep and you're lazy. Okay, go back. Go back so she can get the last slide. I'll continue talking. So you love the sleep, which causes you to hit the snooze. And the reason why you hit the snooze is because you have these thought patterns, which causes emotion inside of you, which says to you, it's okay to be lazy. And then therefore, the action is what? You just sleep in. Enjoying every single minute of it. Correct? You got it? Hit it. The next one. Hit the next one. But the Lashem Shamayim thinking is, as soon as that goes off, and that brain starts saying, oh, it's so nice, it's so great to be sleeping, another thought starts to overcome it that says, you know, you said you're going to pray, and prayer is such a privilege, and what an opportunity it would be to pray this morning and to give God glory and to start your day. That prayer starts to override the other prayer, I want to sleep. So what happens is that thought bypasses the emotions of laziness. And what do? You wake up in time for tefillah. You wake up in time for prayer. Now, that can be used in anywhere. It could be your job. You know what I'm saying? Oh, sorry, I'll be late because you don't get this opportunity very often. I mean, it could do a lot of things. But that's the example. If you let Lashem Shamayim thinking start working in your life. Now, you can't have them in your life because they don't just come automatically. You have to put them in here. Right? I mean, if you don't know that the sun should not go down upon your anger, or that you should, not be angry, being angry, so not, you won't know that. You'll just be angry for as long as you can. If you don't know you're supposed to drop that offense, you'll carry that offense till the cows come home, and sometimes the cows never come home. So you have to have that thinking process. You have to read the book of Proverbs to find out what the wise man says about your mouth. And what does it say about your mouth? And Corinthians, especially 13, what does it say about love and how you're supposed to respond? And go back to those and figure out those love your neighbor. And what does it mean to love your neighbor? And what is he asking you to do? But most of it really go back to talking in your mouth. And if you can get that mouth under control, wow. Hello. Let's face it, most of our problems have been our mouths. Anyone say amen? Unless your arm's frozen, you can't lift it up, you're afraid to break off. I've been having some thoughts about this cold weather right now. You may feel tired, you may feel lazy, but your strong value about prayer that is expressed in your thoughts wins over your desire to stay in bed. My point is, you might have a long way to go. There might be some character stuff in your life that needs to be fixed. But your thoughts and desire to win and to be better and to fix, to kun hamidos, and to be what God wants you to be, not only in a preaching, teaching, apostle, pastor, fivefold ministry, but just in life itself and being a good, moral, Holy Ghost person who can interact and speak and be kind. So, I mean, that's important, right? That desire will cause you to observe yourself, to take notes about yourself, to see about your thoughts, about your feelings, about your actions, and try to fix those things. Amen? Amen. Any questions? Next week, we're going to talk about red flags some more. We're going to talk about spiritual muscle building. And then the following week, we're going to start self-improvement. We're going to see how long we can go in self-improvement. Amen. Let's stand before Adonai. If you can get those cold muscles moving. We're going to sing and you're going to go home. Sing and go home. Hallelujah. I heard a warm front's coming through.
Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are young. We offer up our lives as a living sacrifice.